chapter 2, verses 14 through 26. One, you can follow on page 645 in your pew Bibles. Again, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 14 through 26. And the Word of God reads, "Remind them of these things, and charge them before God not to quarrel about words, which does no good, but only ruins the hearers. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. But avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their talk will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have swerved from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already happened. They are upsetting the faith of some. But God's firm foundation stands, bearing the seal. The Lord knows those who are his. And let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. Now in the great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some of honorable use, some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from what is dishonorable, he will be a vessel for honorable use, set apart as holy, useful to the master of the house, ready for every good work. So flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. Have nothing to do with foolish, ignorant controversies. You know that they bring quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance leading to a knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil after being captured by him."
All right, you may be seated. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much that you are our God, that you sent Jesus to die on the cross in our place, and that you are the restorer of relationships and community. Lord, help us to be the kind of people who listen to your word, who adjust our lives based on your word, who seek unity within the body of Christ, who strive to put away old patterns of behavior like being quarrelsome. Help us to be a people of peace, a people who serve the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. And Lord, when we need the strength to stand strong, not only give us the strength, but give us the wisdom that that is the time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I had an interesting experience this week. I was spending time with a lot of family and friends, and I sat down with one of my cousins whom I don't believe as a believer yet. I think my cousin is questioning and seeking and looking, but I don't think that my cousin has made that decision yet. I will follow Jesus. And so my cousin and I were talking, and I was talking to her about the love of God and the command for us as Christians to love our enemies. And a friend of mine who was very well intentioned, sat down and started arguing for the wrath of God. Now, what my friend said, there wasn't a single thing that my friend said that I didn't agree with. It wasn't what he was saying, it was how it was being said, and in the context of it being there with someone who's trying to figure out who this God is in a world where our culture talks about how mean and angry this old white guy is up in the sky. versus the love that, and faithfulness that we consistently see through Scripture. There wasn't anything that my friend said that was theologically wrong. In fact, I think he probably had a lot more theological accuracy than a lot of preachers I've heard. But it was the timing. It was the context. It was the question, all right, is fighting over these words what the Scripture talks about of being quarrelsome over words? Are we missing the point? Now, I'm not going to get into the details of the exact debate and discussion because I don't want us to get into a quarrel over words this morning. And today's major topic of today's scripture is not the love or the wrath of God. Instead, the major topic of today is us responding to the love of God with different patterns of behavior, avoiding being quarrelsome, avoiding being argumentative. Like I said before, I agree with everything that my friend said. And one of the things that each of us are going to have to look for in a new church, as we're looking for a new church, is this church a church that promotes the unity in the body of Christ, or is it one that picks one particular issue, says, this is the rock I stand on, and sometimes they slip off the rock of Jesus onto that rock? Are we a people who are quarrelsome about words or quarrelsome about doctrine? I am all for having friendly, loving debates between fellow believers about theology. The problem that I know I sometimes run into, and that we as Christians sometimes run into, is it moves from friendly debates to being quarrelsome and divisive. And so as we look for church homes, we need to understand, all right, is this church, are we as a people, this congregation I'm visiting, are we focused on Jesus, or are we focused on some of these side peripheral issues that get us arguing with everybody else? I'm not saying go to a church that doesn't stand for truth. I'm not saying that at all. Go to a church that absolutely stands for truth. But when we as churches beat the same single drum over and over and over again that isn't Jesus, then we've lost our Christ-centered focus. I know that God promises to use all things, including poorly held Christian conversations, for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose. That's clear in Scripture. Yet simultaneously, God calls us through the Apostle Paul not to be quarrelsome in verse 14, and really through the entire passage that was read this morning for us. In fact, verse 14 says that when we quarrel about words, we can ruin those who hear us. When we move past friendly debate into quarrels as Christians, we can do harm to those who are interested in Jesus or spiritually young in their personal faith. Unfortunately, many of us, including myself, get so caught up in being right and correcting others' theologies that we forget about the impact that we can have on those we are charged by God to care for. quarreling and argumentative behavior can have a negative impact on unbelievers or new or young believers, as we've already addressed. But there's another category of people that it can impact that you might not necessarily recognize at first. Quarreling can also have a major effect on seasoned believers. Have any of you ever met a grumpy old Christian?
Yes.
I think we all have. One way that my grandpa would describe attitudes of people like this is that they would sit back with their arms folded and a frown across their face and say, "Impress me." There was one man actually at a church that grandpa would preach at quite often who no matter what grandpa preached on would come up to him after the service with some sort of challenge or correction. One time, Grandpa told him, "I'm just here to rattle your cage." And I'm sure that most of you who knew and remember my grandpa well can even picture the twinkle in his eyes as he said it. As Christians, when we argue with everyone to prove how right we are, we simultaneously harden our hearts like Pharaoh to personal growth given to us through the Holy Spirit and through the Bible. Now I'm going to get really technologically advanced here, and I'm going to use hand puppets. No socks, just hand puppets. When I was younger and leading a Bible study, there was one person in the group who would find something to argue about every time. Sometimes, as I was preparing to lead the Bible study, I would try and figure out, all right, what is this person going to argue about this time? And the reason I would try and ask myself that was so that as believer, as a person that God had placed in authority in that Bible study, I could prepare and protect those others who were in the room so that they would not be harmed by quarreling. It got so bad that one time I brought up a scripture, and the scripture said thus and such. So I said, all right, scripture here is saying number one. The person starts arguing for point number two. The next week, I brought scripture back that was the other side of the coin, the part that he was arguing with, point number two. So I'm like, all right, this scripture talks about point number two. It's the opposite side of the coin of point number one. The person starts arguing against point number two that they had argued for the week before and for point number one that the scripture talked about. When we harden ourselves, when we prepare ourselves with such quarrelsome natures, we harden ourselves to God, we harden ourselves to the Word of God. And no matter what God's word says, no matter what God's people say, we will always find an argument. And it's a prayer as I stand up here, I'm internally praying to God and asking God, protect me from becoming like that. Keep my heart soft. Keep molding me, keep shaping me. Let my theology always be governed by Scripture. And let my heart always be softened by the love of Jesus. Because it really wouldn't take much for any of us to get off the focus of Jesus Christ and onto the focus of trying to be right in every conversation, trying to prove how smart or intellectual we are, to show off how much we've read. And that's one of the dangers that we run into when our walk with Jesus becomes solely about knowing the Word of God rather than doing the Word of God. When we look at Scripture and don't just say, how can I pass the quiz that a seminary student would have to take over this? When we move past that and we say, how can I grow? What action is God calling me to? God calls us through Scriptures to be hearers of the Word, not only hearers of the Word, but doers also. As you encounter the Word of God, and I'm not asking you this to put you completely on the way, maybe a little bit, but does reading the Word of God change your behavior? Does it change the way that you talk about people? Does it change the way that you talk to people? Does it change the internal thoughts that you have when you interact with people you dislike? Or people that don't agree with you? If it doesn't change you, then I'm afraid you may be merely a hearer of the Word and not a doer. You may be knowledgeable about Jesus Christ without truly being a disciple or a follower of Jesus Christ. And that's something we all have to repent of. When we develop patterns of quarreling, we also harm ourselves by hardening our hearts against God. I know that I have answered many fools according to the folly by stepping down into the pit and arguing with them. I'm still learning how to address divisive behavior as a leader in a strong biblical way that is firm and loving at the same time. I don't have that down. In fact, in each situation, it seems different nuances are required based on the leading of the Holy Spirit. For most of us who are firm in our beliefs, we will have to work extra hard not to be quarrelsome. Especially avoiding arguments for argument's sake. When I look back on arguments that I have had with fellow believers, I often wonder, what would the outcome have looked like had I asked questions like, well, what does this specific scripture say? Instead of saying, well, this scripture says this, would I not have put them on the defensive? Would that have given someone an opportunity to actually reflect and come to the conclusions on their own? I don't know about each situation, but I'm pretty sure that some of the situations, that would have been helpful. Verse 17, it shows us that quarreling and irreverent babble spread like a disease gangrene. Our attitudes and habits are often very contagious. So be very intentional what you introduce into the family of God into the church, the body of Christ, and be careful how you represent God to the outside world. One of the areas that I have seen some of the most heated debates occur over in the church is over what is going to happen in the end times. And I must admit and confess, I have gotten into some quarrels over this. In fact, that's the exact same thing that was happening with Hymenaeus and Philetus. They are making up end time stories that haven't happened yet, and it's messing with people's heads. So since he specifically brings up quarrels about the end times, here's what you need to know. Jesus is coming back one day, and we should be ready for that to happen mid-sin or mid-sentence. When he comes back, he will set all things right, both blessing individuals based on the work of Jesus Christ on the cross in their place, or judging us for not trusting in Jesus as our Savior and rebelling against God. We can talk until we're blue in the face about how and when we think Jesus is going to come back. But Jesus said he didn't even know when he was going to return. In Mark 13:32, he tells us that only the Father knows when the Son of Man is coming back. And this all leads us into very personal questions that we must ask ourselves, the chief of which is, do you have a quarrelsome spirit? I want you to know that a quarrelsome spirit, that pattern of behavior, is not a type of behavior that comes from Jesus and faith in him. There will be times when we need to stand firm and defend the truth, but we do not need to be known by our fighting within the body of Christ. Jesus said that we would be known by our love for one another in John 13:35. Are you known as a fighter or someone who, like Jesus, pursues loving people especially when they aren't lovely? The reason that we avoid being quarrelsome and argumentative is the same reason that we love. And that reason can be found in 1 John 4:19. We love because he first loved us. Jesus died for us while we were quarrelsome sinners so that he could save us, so that he could bring us into unity, into community with him and with our fellow believers. Now, in response to the sacrificial love of Jesus, we get to show love to the people who probably least expect it, and often in our minds, least deserve it. We get to show love to those who are argumentative and quarrelsome, because Jesus died to restore our relationship with him and with our fellow humans. In thankfulness for the love Jesus has shown us, we get to be the kind of people who are mentioned in verses 24 and 25 of our passage today. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. Will you be the Lord's servant? Decide now if you will respond to Jesus' sacrificial love in quarrelsome pride or obedient love. Those are your choices. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for sending Jesus to die in our place. Help us respond out of our gratitude, out of the love that you have poured into our hearts, with love for you and love for one another. Help us be a people who are known as followers of Jesus and lovers of people. In Jesus' name, amen. We are going to continue worshiping, so please stand if you are able. We are going to sing Amazing Grace, hymn 1.